Thank you for coming for our artist talk and the exhibition that's currently ongoing as well, Making Desirable Objects, by Bruce Phyllis and myself, Andrea, and Jason as well, who's coming with us today. Just a very, very short introduction about us. Bruce Phyllis and I first worked together when we were part of the dinner residency in Paris, and that was in 2013, and we've actually been working on this show ever since, so it's been a bit more than a year now. What we're looking at around us with Bruce's work in this room and Bruce's works in the other room are either reshowings or reinterpretations of works that they showed in Paris. We also have Kenneth and Samantha from Conditions of Production who have very graciously agreed to help mediate our talk, and I'll just let them sort of introduce Conditions of Production.
Hi, Kenneth here, and so we worked together with Bernice and Melvin at us during the last year, which was a curatorial program that ran for all 9 months, and as the final part of our project, we're presenting Conditions of Production, which is a multi-platform project that had an exhibition, two dialogue sessions, and an online publication that's still ongoing. So with the project, we were trying to involve practitioners, writers, creators, artists, etc., to sort of talk about their, come in and talk about their own practices in relation to the climate that we are making work today. So it can be anything as broad to issues like lack of studio space in Singapore, how do you do ethically with country like Cambodia, with their understanding or with their people consuming Cambodia as almost like a disaster tourism kind of setting. So we had various people coming to write about certain things. We interviewed a few artists, and for the exhibition we worked with 3 Singaporean artists, and it was shown at NUS Museum. So that was what the conditions of production was.
Yeah, and it's actually happening online,
so
www.conditionsofproduction.com if you want to.
It'll be a very informal sort of artist talk today where we'll pretty much be chatting amongst ourselves and asking each other questions. But we really encourage, if anywhere along the way there are any questions that you guys might have, to just ask, to interject, and we won't make this rude at all, because there won't actually be a segregated section for question and answers at the end necessarily.
I'll kind of like to start with a question on how you guys came about this exhibition, or how you came to sort of take reference from OO and speculative realism, just, you know, from the beginning.
I guess so when Samantha talks about OO and speculative realism, I'm not sure how many of you have actually sort of read the very brief write-up that's in the folder in the other room, but we talked about it as being a philosophy that we read a bit about, we understood a bit about, and perhaps allowed to run parallel to our practice, or else we understood it existed but didn't necessarily let it influence or inform our practice. And the, you know, OO, which is object-oriented ontology, stems from speculative realism. And so that's sort of just a very, very brief introduction to what that is. Sure. We got in touch with Jason as soon as, I think it was in 2014 when we got back. Yeah, 2014, yeah. So we got back before myself, so we got in touch with Jason to ask about possibly exhibiting in group projects. And Jason said yes, but also that he would like to be a part of the show rather than just renting out the space. And of course, we're very happy to have him alongside us because he's very experienced as a curator, as an artist as well. And so we saw it as a great way to open up again the different dynamics, because I mentioned we worked together, and so when we had somebody else, like Jason, come aboard, it would be, you know, various, as a sounding board, as well as a new facilitator as well. And so that's quite an exciting adventure. So in one of the first few meetings, he sat down and he talked about both Bruce and Melissa's works as, he basically floated the idea of the Anthropocene. So before he sort of tasked us with reading such meetings, that's sort of the word, the key word that stuck with me today. And I didn't really remember that word so much, and because I was quite consumed by the meetings, and I was a bit resistant to the philosophy of OOO, and I still am in a sense today. But I think what's helped me a little bit along the way is remembering this idea of the Anthropocene, and I recognize that in a sense in both Bruce and Bruce's works. So in a sense where they've taken very organic elements, whether it's in Bruce's work, geology and crystals, or in Bruce's ideas about the stars, this particular work, but it's very much man-manipulated. And so I sort of, for me personally, and then I think I'll let Elizabeth Bruce talk about it a bit more, that was my engagement with that philosophy from the beginning. And I mentioned being a bit resistant towards it up to now. But not in a bad way. I think having read about it and the various things that have popped up, whether it's other speculative realists. So speculative realism breaks into four sort of components. So it's either reading the various other speculative realists other than OOO, or else reading things completely not focused on speculative realism, and so like neo-materialism, for example. And so in this exercise of reading what I still consider a very difficult philosophy, there have been various other aspects that have cropped up that have piqued my interest and have allowed me to anchor myself to OOO in a sense, or else pivot around it with this show. How it started for you guys is, I came from a very, I guess, differently, also a little bit later as well.
In terms of the actual arguments themselves?
Yeah, I guess it could be, as I said, the genesis, and I guess, and your experience working with our group, I think, and from the beginning, maybe the process.
I think it would be easier for me to speak generally about the genesis of this particular artwork, which essentially began with the observation that within urban centers, if you look at the stars at night, you don't see a damn thing, there's no stars, maybe four or five stars. And of course, stars have been tremendously significant to many people, many cultures over many thousands of years. And let's assume that that tendency to seek significance and meaning from those patterns didn't just up and vanish once we could see the stars as a result of light pollution. But I decided to speculate that it simply grafted itself onto a new available host, that is to say, artificial source of light, that is essentially what's going on here.
From the cast of the rock, and I can show you later on
what you can actually see, the rock that I found itself, the other two rocks disintegrated when I did the cast, so there is no rock for that piece. But the one in the closest to the entrance, you can actually see that there is a physical rock. And for me, I felt the whole piece can be seen as a whole when put together with the mechanical parts and the found rock. Because otherwise the relation would be difficult to see. So that would be very much the whole concept of black thoughts that help this work.
Actually, I wanted to perhaps, since Melissa, you've been sharing about the materials and the components that go into your work, I was wondering if you could perhaps share more about the processes that go into your work, because for me it's interesting because it's almost invisible, like the data that goes into the algorithms. Also, I think another point that was really interesting for me is when you talk about art as a source of light, and the method of presenting your work is also through an artificial source of light, projector. And having that sort of was it something that's conscious for you to want to project this image onto a wall as opposed to, I don't know, another way of presenting the world? Was it something, the conscious vision?
Well, let me work up to that by explaining what goes into the production of this. Essentially, it involves wandering around the city at night and taking photographs of it. As the project iterated from city to city, I began to sort of formalize the approach which governed the selection of what to photograph and what sort of angles and so on and so forth. And one key aspect was always ground level in a place that would be typically accessible on foot, and also not monuments, not icons and edifices, not your skylines and so on and so forth. So one wanders around the city. In some versions of this project, I've worked remotely, and so I do it by looking for geotagged images on Google Image Search or Flickr, and then harvesting those and processing them. And there was one time where I got them crowdsourced. So once they're in my hands, I basically strip out everything in the image that isn't the source of light, and then turn that into a white one transparent vector in a vector file. Then, so you've got this big pool of image files, which the script running on the laptop over there selects at random up to 8, and then rotates them at varying rates for a random interval of time. By my estimations, it should not be possible to ever see a repeated at the exact same configuration. So from moment to moment, that configuration, in all probability, will never be seen again. Another part of it, which I think has been turned down since we're all talking, is an audio component based on field recordings of, so to speak, typical urban sounds. So footfalls of people walking past, or people sitting down for a meal at a cafeteria, stuff like that. And then I process it to remove most of the audible range. And so what you have with is very low frequencies and very high frequencies. And just a little bit of filtering to make it resemble the use of sonification in radio astronomy, which radio astronomers use to process data from radio telescopes, which would normally be big strings of numbers, something which the average person would be ill-equipped to sense patterns in. But once it's been translated into this different format, it's more intuitive to see the patterns. And as far as the choice of projection, I don't think that was a conscious decision. I just thought that it was the most practical, most sensible mode of presenting this work, although I had
sound is actually something that you want that you sort of play with and work with this new work. So you worked with like the prototype of a music box in Paris, and then over here you wanted to recreate it from scratch. Mm-hmm. And I think there was talk amongst us that, you know, we were thinking about like the drum or something. It was actually built on the cast of the rock. So we were, I think Andrea mentioned that she actually expected that it to be the rock itself, but rather you actually re-represented the rock by creating a different, a separate kind of cast for it. So I guess the question is, I guess why the sort of drive towards creating that moment rather than, you know, putting the object there in itself to interact with it? Was it because it needed to sort of produce music?
Yes. For me, I thought that it was very important to have kind of sound element. And so when I actually put the rock itself and the foam and the machinery, mm-hmm. it may or may not produce a kind of sound that. So that was very essential for me to create the cast to actually get the pins to form. So it was basically a technical issue.
So I guess in that sense it's more of like the sound would play then. And I guess I also found it interesting that your work actually involves that kind of activation by the human hand, in the sense that you are pulling that wrench, as opposed to like using something like a motor, which is more automatic, which sort of plays even when it's not activated. So I guess, was it something that you considered?
Yes, I did consider that. There were options of actually just looking at, but I wanted the human hand and the viewer themselves to be part of the entire process. So it's like a system of objects that make up the poem, the rock, the cast of the rock, the human, the visitor themselves have become an object to engage with the entire thing.
Okay, so I think
that's
all
again, to sort of what was interesting was Melissa went in through our conversation. She always talks about how it's very important to observe the material, and that is why up to very recently, I thought it would be us observing the rock literally and perhaps a comb that brushes and it gently hits it to produce a sound. But in her talking about how us as objects as well in interacting with other objects is observing objects differently in a way that, so in what I'm trying to say, I think my struggle with the philosophy was when they talked about how the human hand was being seen as playing too much too main a part in our understanding objects, and so we should look for means and ways to just observe the object. And I think in a sense hearing this explanation again about how to understand humans ourselves as objects and as interacting with other materials as objects, that is her interpretation in a sense of that philosophy. So it needn't have just been something that was just looking at elements of nature and then observing it for what it is, but it was her reacting with that philosophy in a sense and deciding that humans are objects as well.
I guess like it's kind of interesting because like in our conversations we talked a little bit about how like FOMO is not so instead of talking about how like it's like a very different kind of everything exists in equally, it's more like focused on the removal of that human hand. So it's still rather like human-centric because you're always focusing on that rejection,
yeah,
as opposed to focusing on objects and how they interact with your own.
I suppose that was something that I also found interesting in this as well, because it does seem to take our interaction with the art as though we are an object interacting with another object in an entire ecosystem. I
think I was quite interested in how Melissa's book actually anticipates the viewer into that, to the structure of the artwork, like I mentioned just now, where she could have opted for a motor or something else that was, would have been more automatic rather than you having to recreate it. And then,
in a sense also, perhaps bypass all the potential problems.
Yeah.
Because,
what happened with the cones and,
there is not much of a direction. I only stuck a directional arrow to how the music box should be turned. But on the day of the opening, a lot of people just reacted quite differently. Some quite violently, some quite, they would do it this way, and then have to change direction, and then the cones started breaking bit by bit. And the material also reacted in turn to the way the viewer determined how reacted to the object. So it was quite different the way we ourselves approach the works.
Comment?
Yeah.
So I find it interesting you said, it's not a motor that's automatic that does it, it's the human interaction. But you bring a human into proximity with a machine that has gears that are visible, and it's almost a certain interaction anyway. It's practically as automatic as a motor. But the only difference, I guess, one could think of the human turning it as just another gear. The first gear turns the others. Is that kind of what makes the objectification of the human? But the intentionality doesn't matter anymore? Or is that, did you think about that as a play part for you?
Well, for me, I basically, the human hand would turn it, but it would eventually be up to the person. There were some people who actually not even turn the box up, they would just observe it. And it was quite different. So how everyone reacts to it was quite different. Most people would turn it, but there were some people also to turn it, which is observed. So, the paper book in Paris also started to disintegrate from what we've played and what we've called the critical part because it's been from how we defined us from 10 and soon after the view, one of the viewers actually helped me to tear off a piece of the paper because it started jamming me with the piece. So even the viewer reacting and helping me to tear to get the music to me, the material is really different in comparison to. So here the metal piece started to break and that would also react, like the material itself reacted to the human hand.
I'd like to take this opportunity, since I asked you about your own view, to ask Bruce as well about the web you showed in the 2012. Yeah, 2013. So it was in that Singapore.
Yeah.
The hex codes. I mean, so what Bruce did was using the postal codes throughout Singapore and translated that into hex codes for GB.
So basically, I just happened to notice that the postcodes we use here in Singapore, they have 6 digits. And 6 digits is the same number of digits as hexadecimal RGB code. So I decided to translate one into the other to see what a color map of Singapore's buildings might look like. And along the way, I also fudged a little by adding buildings that didn't exist or buildings that might never exist, as well as omitting entire neighborhoods and sort of animating the whole thing so it was shimmery and out of view. Also, it's got a delightfully unpronounceable title, which is 6 hashes. I just call it a hash. But is there something specific about that?
I think it's more this work exists in many different iterations, right? Mm-hmm. So was this work something that came, something that you made before?
So this came first,
would you see your work as? So I think Samantha and I were talking about the relationship that your work has with the viewer and how, for example, this work, it's always an uncertainty about what you're seeing, and I think earlier you explained about the relationship it has to start with constellations, but also because of the way the work is never the same, and obviously comes the whole idea of astronomy is that the stars can be mapped out.
It can be predictable.
Exactly. So I think there's a tension there in the relationship. That, I think with the hex hash, it's interesting as well because this is interesting in a very different way in the sense that you kind of, there's almost no gradations between the colors. My mistake. And perhaps going even further, Hall of Mirrors, and that one looks at the events, right?
Yeah.
And sound recordings?
Not so sure. The sound of that particular piece was achieved by basically you've got all these clocks in a room, and each one tracks the average rate of incidence for a given locality, such as Southeast Asia or the Asia Pacific. Various horrible things like murders and deforestation. So each time that hand goes around once, that's one instance of that particular thing. And because they all happen at very different rates, all these hands that are turning at different rates, each clock has a chime of a different pitch, and each time it goes around once is a chime. So essentially it translates, in a fairly literal sense, the suffering of millions into tinkling bell sounds. So it was essentially accidental music of suffering.
And I think it's interesting, coming back to the viewer or the spectator, it's, we're always impervious to what we're hearing, we're always impervious to, well, that's a chime, but what does that actually mean? So I guess in that sense, we were talking about how your artworks or your objects, or if you view the installation as an object that does not want to be known, or in a certain way resists that tendency for us to want to know something. And
I think I enjoy the idea that I am managing to frustrate our capacity to project and make meaning.
Right.
This piece in particular, one point of view that you could have is that it essentially sort of a reaction to notions of astrology, where when they use the relative positioning of the stars and other heavenly bodies as a means by which to determine personality or future events. When we look at the stars and we identify constellations and make up stories about them, the stars themselves don't give a damn. They're sufficient in themselves, they're just flaming balls of gas millions and millions of light years away. They don't give a damn. And so, any meaning that results from that is meaning that we come up with, which is bound, it's solipsistic essentially. So I wanted to play around with the idea with this thing that it's not entirely random, but it is pseudo-random. There is enough non-randomness as a sort of texture that you could maybe latch onto, maybe try to determine a pattern or an image or meaning, anything, but there isn't really. I like to think of it as an engine of indifference.
I'm guilty as charged, but I love pop.
Yeah, I love pop.
Yeah, well, Bruce mentioned about, like, in previous work with the talk, you mentioned about, like, the postal codes you could do to sort of translate them into, like, the hex codes. And I think I see, like, a kind of similar way in which, and we actually talked about it also, and, like, Melissa also used the word, like, translation, where you were in Paris and then you saw the textures of the roads and you sort of translated them into music themselves. So I guess this also ties into the conversations that we had about translation and mapping and how does it sort of figure into both of your practices. And I was wondering if we could talk more about that. And, like, maybe we can start with Andrea. Because it was something that you were considering from the start.
Yeah. So for me, I think when I was reflecting on the work of their works, and I spoke to the listeners as well, the conversation that I just can't help but see that it's just mapping, whether it's in Willis's past works, whether it's mapping crystals and the way they appear to shatter, for example, or also with the collaboration in Paris, which is mapping that section of that specific metro station, or with this one, with mapping the rocks, and with Bruce's, whether it's polymers with all of his network architecture, all of his mapping of the data, but in a way that Andrew's informed, he likes to turn maps in on themselves, where it's not supposed to serve as what maps do, which is to navigate you to a destination that exists or to where you need to get, but it really scrambles things in a sense. So that was my sort of observation and projection.
It wasn't really, well, mapping Singapore, maybe when I first saw the rocks, and yes, it would be the rock sounds from that particular rock, from that location, so in a way, maybe, but it wasn't specifically about that aim, but in a way,
specifically for the series and for the music boxes and stuff. So So I think if you look at that on its own, it's quite interesting that we both decided to have that relation. I mean, not a relationship per se, but to have that relation exist in the locality. Whether or not it's about a map or a mapping place. Another thing that I wanted, earlier when I spoke to you, where we mentioned about the projection of this and how it's also not a conscious source of life. I think one thing I'm really interested in is the idea of projection, or the idea of the screen, or like whatever this projection is projected on as a surface. I mean, it's a surface, right? But a surface is material. And how we, for example, this whole relationship that we have to cinema and like art, contemporary arts, so bringing in the projection or bringing in that history of having cinema into like this contemporary art exhibition space. So for me, it's interesting that your work and the works that I've seen from you are like projections. And also, I think you kind of casually mentioned also about the idea of projection mapping, that it's something you're considering. And of course, that's also that how we talk about network architecture and this projection of this onto the city again. It's interesting for me. Not just in the, oh, it's you can project it bigger, but I think it has its own, attendant consequences when you project onto the city. And a projection is always a projection onto something. Just somehow representing those balls of light in this object.
Oh, that's three-dimensional.
Yeah.
Mm. That's something to think about, but not at present. I haven't really given that much thought about
it. So early on you talked about how there's the randomness to this, but it's a pseudo-randomness. Do you think that the pseudo-randomness also contributes to perhaps instability, not in a derogatory manner, but in just generic instability of the work?
When you have total randomness, what you have is essentially white noise. It's profoundly boring. But if it's only slightly random or mostly random, then you essentially have sensory, I suppose we might call them hooks, like things that look like they might mean something. And so, yes, I think instability is a good way to refer to it. Yeah.
We hope direction to Melissa too, in regards to how I know that you wouldn't call your, so your work and the way the poem was kind of like, broke off in that sense. So I think right now I do sense your art object is kind of in a state of stability, but do you consider that part of the work? Because there is the artwork and then that's the art object, kind of the realization in this sense.
I think that's why I intended, I'm just going to leave it in due course of the sexual exhibition, this entire situation, the exhibition, these three poems, and then. Yes.
I think that adds that level of, for me, another layer of the performance of the art object here. So you're not, in that sense, it doesn't have to be this thing that never changes. The art object is, for me, in a state of flux, no matter what.
So would it be open to part replacement at any given point, or no?
Yes, I would replace it.
I guess it would depend on if the first purchaser really wants the artwork of Melissa Tan or the artwork of Melissa Tan and gallery visitors. They do in a very small way become participants in the creation of the artwork as it is now, right? Even though it may have been detrimental at first, one could see value in it.
Okay. Let's go back to Nigel Desirable.
Yeah, the next thing I had to pass the song to the system, and then I put it all together to talk.
thought about was that it's very labor intensive in the sense that there is a lot. This is very obvious trend of like workmanship and that kind of you are working with your hands. It's very obvious, and I mean when I'm looking at your previous works, it's also that same attention to that kind of fabricating and like manipulating or manufacturing the object. And I also remember that was something that you were conscious of. You know that that there's this.
I do like having a hand in the work. Actually, I wanted to expose the side of the drum, so you can actually see the materials inside. But because of the technical difficulties, the drum was very, very heavy. So I had the metal engineer actually told me to encase it, and then it would turn that way. So in case that if I put a rod through, the rod could not, it may or may not stick to the center, the center part of the plaster, and then it would cause the entire thing to fall. So it was because of technical issues that I had to change my
kind of interesting because that we had like Bruce and Melissa both talk about like other ways that they would present the work. And I guess my question is to Andrea, like if you know, were there other ways that you wanted to present this exhibition right from the start? Was it always an exhibition or how did
I think at the beginning when we first decided that we were going to show together, I felt that it was going to be a show.
Mm-hmm.
And then as it progressed, I think there were perhaps my own thoughts about how it could take a different shape, but I think for their works and because of the effectiveness of it being in a space, particularly where I think when I understood, knowing what Melissa's work was like, perhaps in Paris, where you needed that person to be there to manipulate the handle of the music box, for example, it sort of needed to have that physical presence and needed to be in a physical space and have the audience be a part of the show as well. So I think it became a point where it had to be an exhibition.
And there's a catalog.
Yeah, there's a catalog. I'm not entirely sure when it will be published yet, but it will be about a conversation between us. Images of their works, an essay about the show, and well, not so much about the show, I think about their individual works and really their individual practices, and about OOO and neo-materialism. And we're not entirely sure, perhaps, what else might go into it. And actually, at this juncture, we're not sure if it will necessarily take a physical shape, actually, because I mean, through all of what's happened, and I think I think the question that arises is how important it is that this catalog needs to be something people can hold, if perhaps Bruce's works are best seen as a video, perhaps rather than still, or Melissa's work you can see the people interacting. So that's something that's sort of I've been wondering for a little bit.
Something that I just wanted to just ask you guys about what your work now, what are your current interest in, whether it be research or future projects. Perhaps you guys could share. Touch on that, and then maybe we could end the session there.
Yeah, sure.
Post-carrot.
As far as future projects go, I have work coming at the moment, currently in Tokyo and next up Osaka, but it's an old work. As far as new work goes, I'm still trying to come up with something. Hopefully, before the year ends.
Be in the same, not the same, but like your continuing career or your continuing interest in.
I think for one time I wanted to step away from highly labor-intensive things that can easily break down. Because it's terribly annoying when they travel. Because I always get these panicky emails. Also, throwing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours into a given work is getting a bit old.
That, whether it's